We're doing a little giveaway action tonight, hence the game show Muzak. Yeah! Thanks for joining us live. Let's see who's here today. Chris, thanks for tuning in. Info Bobby. Ew, boomer. No, I swear, I'm not a boomer. This show's still in the air, you know? I'm just a really cool Gen Z. Hey, Timothy. Hey, Marie. You getting down with a little Wheel of Fortune? Somebody just called me out as a boomer, believe it or not. Hey, Yayo fam. Alex, MC Spicy Dan, good to see you guys. Thanks for tuning in live. For those of you that might not know, tonight's guest is George Whittam, aka George the Tech. George has been, for many years, one of the go-to guys for voice actors creating home studios. He did my home studio as well as so many others. And not only is George an amazing person, thank you for sending me the invite, but he's also here to answer some questions. So we're going to save the last 10 minutes for questions. So if you have questions, get them ready. Let's go live with George, guys. Get it ready. Woo! Let's go, Tasker! Hey, Jeff Howell. It's so good to see your face. You know what?
Hey, that there.
That literally timed out perfectly. The theme song just ended and you are here.
Awesome, awesome. I know these IG Live things, they're always a little rough to get started because there's no real... It's not super elegant the way they start, but I think we got it right tonight.
And then, like, it's... Yeah, I'm, like, been realizing you need to vamp in the beginning. You really... Yeah. You can't jump into it or people miss because it sends out the alert and then people need to get to their phones and...
I also have no idea what microphone I'm using right now.
I know. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, but I mean, am I using this mic?
Potentially. Am I using this mic?
Do you hear scratchy?
Yes.
Is it making a scratchy noise?
Yeah.
So is this microphone right here? Is this the right one?
Uh-huh. That's going to be the cover shot of this, just like...
I don't know. I don't know about that.
Definitely not. Definitely not. It's good to see your face, George. How are you doing?
You too. You too. How are you?
I'm doing great. Happy Wednesday.
Thanks. I just got home.
Oh, wow.
I still do have to leave the house to see certain clients. In fact, I just came from visiting my client that I love to call Client Zero.
Oh,
although
yeah?
Maybe right now during the pandemic, it's not a good nickname, but I just came from Howard Parker.
Okay.
He's the guy that got me started inadvertently got me started doing voiceover studio tech stuff. So,
you know, that's interesting. It is it's a niche category within an already somewhat niche market. And I was curious, you know, I know a little bit about your story, but can you tell us kind of how you made the leap from boom operator, audio engineer to specifically home studios for voice actors?
Yeah, I mean, coincidentally, it really does come down to Howard. When I was in Philadelphia, I was doing radio engineering, remote radio engineering, broadcast engineering for 94WYSP, an FM station there. That was the Howard Stern station. We were one of the big stations in Philly, and we were the Eagles football team station.
Wow.
So I was interning with my friend who was the engineer doing all those gigs on the road for the team. And I'd heard about it through my cousin, Andy, that they were working on this stuff together. And I was like, man, I need to get in on this. How can I intern? How can I be there? Long story short, I got to do a couple intern gigs on the field, one on the field holding the big parabolic dish microphone and one in the booth. And then 9/11 attacks happened. And then my friend Lane, who was the engineer, said, you know, I don't want to do this stuff anymore. I don't want to travel. He was genuinely afraid of flying and travel. A lot of people were.
Yeah.
And he was like, you might be the only one that can do this job, even though you've only been in the studio in the booth one time and watched me run this thing, but you might be the only guy. But I don't know if you'll get the gig because, you know, plenty of people want this gig. And then I got the gig. And then also through that connection with the station and my buddy Lane, I ended up meeting Howard Parker. And he was moving into New York City and needed his first voiceover studio in his apartment. So Lane and I put that studio together. Now, this was in 2001-ish. So flash forward 2004, I moved to L.A. And then Howard caught wind that I was in L.A. now. And so when he needed something technical with his home studio, he said he looked me up and helped him with his home studio. And then he connected me with his management, Jason Marks Talent, whom he is still with today. And then they connected me with Rick Wasserman, Rick Robles, Melissa Disney. And the rest is just kind of foggy. I don't remember what happened from there. Those are my first four or five clients. So
a lot of
lucky working. Yeah, I got lucky working with great talent.
Yeah. Well, I remember, I think I met you at, was it That's Voiceover, the first year they did That's Voiceover?
Probably.
You wandered into your booth?
Was it in L.A. or in Disney or one of those?
Oh, gosh. I'm thinking of the event. I think it was That's Voiceover when they came to L.A. So maybe the second That's Voiceover.
Maybe 2008? Was it 2008?
2008? Was it that long ago?
Could be, because that's when I also met Dan Leonard, which is why VOBS became a thing.
Yeah.
So that was a fateful event.
I remember I had definitely been hearing your name and you had a reputation. And then I was like, Hi, I'm Allie. Nice to meet you. You know, and it was, the rest is history. So tell us a little bit about your podcast that you do with Dan.
Yeah, the show is The Voiceover Body Shop. It started 10 years ago, almost exactly. Our 10th anniversary comes up next month. And it started as East West Audio Body Shop because Dan, when I met Dan in 2008, he was still living in Buffalo, New York. And I was already here in L.A. So we started a remote show. And it really was like a live talk show, a radio show. In fact, it was really modeled after car talk. So
I can see that.
Yeah. We were trying to be like a click and clack, answer tech questions, try to make it fun and make it light. And that was the whole premise behind the whole thing. So we started it based on that. And then 10 years later, we're still doing it. We just renamed the show when Dan moved to LA 5 years ago because East West didn't make any sense anymore. And one of our fans came up with the idea of VOBS, Voiceover Body Shop. I was like, perfect. That's the name of the show, VOBS. And it's just, it just stuck. And
goes with your car talk theme.
Totally. Yeah. And we've always tried to have a little bit of humor and keep it light, but we answer a ton of questions and we get to do a lot of interviews. And I don't know why. Why have you not been interviewed on our show? Have you been avoiding us?
You know what I think? I remember there was some conflict. You did ask me a couple years ago, I think, when you were doing the studio build. Tasker was on the show, Jim Tasker.
Years ago. He was in my house.
What was that?
He was in my house when I lived in Santa Monica.
Oh, I thought you said he slept over your house, which I think would be really adorable. You
guys
cuddled up on my sofa with like...
Yeah. Jim's appearance on EWABS is really good. I mean, he had some really great... Go back and type in EWABS Jim Tasker in YouTube and find it. It's really good. But yeah, that's how that show came together. And then we put it up as a podcast for people that are in the car. Some people mm-hmm. still drive around and listen to podcasts. So... And that's how that show came to be. And we have a lot of fun. And at the end of the day, we just promote ourselves. It's all we really do. It's just their shameless promotion.
Whatever works, right? No. So I'm curious. We do have, because you guys know, we're doing a giveaway. Our very first giveaway on Alicyn's Wonderland. And it's been super fun. So we're going to do that at the end of the show. This is my very official ballot box right
You really did do that? You really printed them out and cut them all?
I wrote them.
Get the heck out of here.
Yeah, that's how high tech we are. I don't own a printer. I had one and it broke. But it's been really fun to kind of, you know, try something different. But I was curious because I know a lot of people that were interested in the contest are new voice actors trying to build up their home studios. And I was wondering, for somebody just starting out, what are the basics? I'm sure you probably have a podcast about it, so we can link to that after. But what are the basics that people need?
Yeah, actually, I've talked about this in different formats over the years. I actually wrote a blog post on it on my blog, georgethe.tech. If you go to the blog on there, it's like the top 10 things a voice actor needs to know. And it really goes into a lot of depth. So for those that want a really in-depth answer, I recommend looking that up. But the key things are you need quiet. We still don't have a way to get rid of dog barks and kids screaming and helicopter sounds in a way that's perfect and automated. So we still have to fix that at the source. It's got to be quiet. Then you need to get rid of the reverb or echo in your room. And then you need to learn how to work a microphone so that you get good clean audio without plosives and without sounding like you're on the radio and still sounding natural and sounding like you're acting and a microphone is inches from your face, but no one would ever think it because it doesn't sound like you're acting. Right. These are tricks. It's not easy. It certainly has nothing to do with how good your voice sounds, because God knows I can't tell you how many people have told me, even people in this business, "Wow, you've got a good voice. Have you ever done voiceover?" Like, you know what? How you do? You guys know how hard this is to be really successful in voiceover. It's a heck of a lot of work. So
And you
I.
also need George Whittam. So who would be your George Whittam?
Right, it'd probably be Dan Leonard, but yeah, you need a lot of it takes a tech a lot of training. So don't overinvest in crazy expensive gear. Don't buy the golden microphone that you think is the one that's going to win you gigs, because it's not going to.
Like the
Spend that
literally
money on,
golden microphone, or you mean like the name mic?
just fill in the blank expensive popular mic that all the voiceover forums and say you need to have. You've got two of the most well-known, well-loved microphones in the business right in front of you.
Beautiful.
A TLM Neumann
But
TLM-103 and a Sennheiser MKH-416. It's
you're saying
Sennheiser.
this is not your recommended getting started list.
No.
Oh, it's a little bit.
If you, I mean, just like every, you know, somebody gets a Mercedes for their Sweet 16. Good for them. But you don't, most people don't, and you don't need it. So you need just a good quality sounding signal from a good sounding microphone, and that, believe it or not, can be as low as $100.
Yeah.
And
Any
then you need like,
mics
yeah,
off the
well,
top of your
Audio Technica stuff. You really can't go wrong with anything Audio Technica at any price point, as long as it's a condenser mic. So you want to look at the AT20, 2020. I like the 2035. If you can pony up the extra $40. I like the 2035. And Rode microphones, NT1, NTG4. This is an NTG4 right here. It's a shotgun mic. This one here is the NTG5. It's a little more pricey at $500, more than most people would need to spend. But yeah, you're just looking for a good quality condenser mic that's not noisy, has low self noise, doesn't make a lot of hiss. Doesn't require you to turn the gain on your preamp all the way up to get a good recording level. Because as soon as you do that, guess what? It gets really hissy. So you don't want those Shure SM7Bs that Joe Rogan and all the podcasters are using. Not a good voiceover mic. And then you want to have a reliable computer that doesn't give you fits. If you're
But don't they
frustrated,
all?
yeah, I know. And you know, I'm an Apple person, and I know you use Apple, and
Yeah.
it doesn't mean it's going to be completely pain-free. But I am of the strong opinion that Apple computers really are still designed around audio and video production. And so when you're doing that job, they provide far less resistance to doing that. So I'm a really big fan of using Mac computers for voiceover production. There's plenty of you Windows people out there. If you're using Windows, there's usually two reasons. One, you don't know any better, or two, you do know better, and you just love Windows. And you just love building computers, hacking them. You're a gamer. Customizing computers is fun. Or your brother-in-law is an IT guy and he fixes everything for you so you never have to think about it. Then you can be a Windows user. But for everybody else who's a creative who doesn't want to have to think about all that stuff and just wants to have an Apple store to call, or Apple is the way to go. So there's my Apple versus PC. And this is a debate that will go on forever. And I will sometimes alienate some people in the process, but that's okay. But yeah, those are all the really important things. A pair of headphones you can trust. You don't want to use Beats by Dre because they're not EQ'd for accuracy. They're really EQ'd for fun, for music. You've got the Sonys. So there's a lot of kind of headphones that are studio specific, like the Sonys. Like the Beyerdynamics that I've used for 20 years, these DT770s. These new ones, these are the Austrian Audio HIX55, which I did a whole review of just recently.
Yeah.
And we spanned it just now talking about headphones, a price from $100 to $350. And you can spend more, you can spend less, but really the sweet spot for a good pair of studio headphones is about $100. So the Sonys, the Audio Technicas are two of my most favorite in that price range. Some people like the Sennheiser HD280s. You know, the headphones are very, very personal because these are the things that are physically on your body.
Yeah.
So, and your ears and the way you hear is unique to you, and it's unique to the pair of headphones you're wearing. So when I hear myself now in these headphones, it sounds quite different than if I was talking and wearing these headphones. And so I have to actually get used to the way this sounds. Yeah. It's quite different. So whatever it is, you have to be familiar with it, and you have to have time to become adjusted to those headphones. Mm-hmm. And it takes months sometimes, even years. So those are the big, big things. And then training, coaching. And then learning how to use your equipment, and then getting your audio tuned right. Those are all these things go hand in hand. And we're not talking 10 to 20 grand here. I mean, a lot of us can spend less if you are blessed with a quiet space. Mm-hmm. Now, if you live in, let's say, Toluca Lake, maybe you need a soundproof studio. Just saying.
Well, yeah. I mean, we're directly in the flight path here. And obviously, you can't be holding every 5 minutes for a plane when you're in a session. Auditions, maybe you can work around it, although it does kind of mess up your flow. So a lot of people actually start in their closets.
Sure. Yep, closets.
But then, you know, if you're beginning your career and then you're working in the closet, that might be fine for 30 minutes, an hour at a time. But if you have a 2 or 4 hour session, you got to think about airflow and just the comfort. And that's, I think, one of the things that becomes the longer term investment. So maybe, you know, after a few years when you're working and you maybe feel, although Vanessa, closets rock. For some people, that's just perfect, especially if you have a bigger closet. Potentially you might feel if you're going to work every day, you might not want to be in your closet.
Folks that live in, you know, Texas, Florida, other markets, Atlanta. Real estate's a lot cheaper down there.
You can just buy a whole new house.
You can buy a 4 or 5 bedroom house for the price of a 2 bedroom apartment in LA, and you can have spare rooms and a whole walk-in closet. And so in certain areas, it is much easier to get started as a voiceover because of just those purely practical reasons. Mm-hmm. So it's New York City is one of the hardest because who has the space and the quiet? It's really difficult to do this stuff from home in the city. So
what was Howard's workaround for your first studio build?
Well, the first one we set up for him in New York City was what I still consider the classic voiceover announcer setup, which is a whisper room, a Sennheiser 416, a Mackie mixer, an ISDN Zephyr box. I think he had Pro Tools, still uses Pro Tools. That's what I remember. We probably had a nice outboard mic preamp as well on top of all that. I'm sure we do. He still uses a red Focusrite Red 7. That's what he likes to use. But that's it. And I didn't even realize that those booths sounded pretty lousy out of the box, frankly. They weren't
really
acoustically treated very well. And I hate to tell you, but Whisper Room, if anybody is listening over there, they still sound pretty bad 20 years later. And I've been talking to them. They know me. I've seen them at all the trade shows. I've talked to them hundreds of times. They totally know me. And they have not yet made a better sounding whisper room acoustical treatment that comes with the booth. Anyway.
Dan Leonard says, who's this guy?
Who's this guy?
For anybody that's just tuning in from my side, this is George Whittam. He is the go-to voiceover guy, voiceover audio guy, helping people all across the country, everybody from Tara Strong to Alicyn Becker.
Alicyn Becker.
To Lori Allen. Thank you. Gorgeous Lori Allen. Get set up with their home studios. So do you have a tweak that you use them for whisper rooms to make them sound good if one of your clients already has that?
Yeah, it's not that hard, but you have to be willing to give up a little bit of space in there. The key thing is I use these things called the ATS Acoustics Corner Bass Trap.
Okay.
And it's a little intimidating because it's very big. So people get one of these and they're like, oh my gosh, this is going to take up a lot of space in here. But it doesn't really, because it doesn't take up any usable space. You know, when you're standing in a square box or a rectangle, there's always spaces in the corners, especially in front of you, you know, the front corners that are totally unused. You might have a mic boom in there or something, but that's it. There's nothing there. So you stick one of these huge bass traps in the corner and it immediately changes the sound of the booth. It completely changes it and it tightens up the sound. It sounds more dry and dead, gets rid of the resonance and, it's not a huge investment. I mean, you can buy one of these shipped to your door for around $200, the bass trap, and it is immediate transformation. So
is that different than the acoustic paneling that we have here?
It's different in its shape. So the paneling you have on the walls are a flat panel, and the panel I'm describing is a prism. It's shaped like a prism. It's a triangle. If you look at it from the top, it's a triangle, and then it has a flat face. Right, that. So it goes, it's a corner mounted thing. That really transforms the whisper room. So you can't, you might start with something that sounds boxy and hollow. And some people end up doing years and years of work in these and never know the difference. They just don't know because nobody pointed it out to them, especially audiobook folks. Mm-hmm. The bar for audio quality, at least acoustically in audiobooks, is really low. People get away with a lot. As long as it's quiet, usually the production company is good with it. It can sound like they're 10 feet away from the mic and it can sound hollow, whatever, but as long as it's quiet, they tend to be happy. So they don't even realize how bad the sound actually is because they don't hear it in context with other types of voiceover. And then when they want to leap in from audiobooks into the next crossover through that magical looking glass into commercials or something, then they realize, whoa, I'm falling way short and I had no idea. So it's a funny thing. It's a funny thing. And I've set up tons of whisper rooms 10 to 20 years ago that I never considered tuning them or changing the acoustics. I didn't know any better. You don't know what you don't know. But now I've heard so many good studios and now I know how to tune them better. So if you worked with me 12 years ago and you haven't talked to me since, maybe it's time for another call. Well, I might have learned a few things since then.
And that's it. You know, we're always learning and growing and keeping at the edge of tech and at the edge of our industry. It means so much has changed since, COVID happened. And just even a year ago, most of the animation sessions were going to studios. Most of the commercial sessions, unless it was an ongoing gig, you're going into a studio. And now I've only been into a studio 3 times and it was for the same job. Everything else has been from home. Now, granted, I have a broadcast quality studio here, so it's just as easy. But there's definitely, would you say that there's a trend toward even more of the home studio than ever before?
Yeah. I mean, it's just because out of just pure necessity, there's a lot of people who are either not permitted to work in their studio, commercial studios, or the actors are afraid to go into the commercial studio. They don't even want to go in there. And in some cases, there just is no commercial studio in the production process because the engineer is working from a home studio. The director is working from their home office. The clients are sitting in their kitchens with their families watching TV. And That's the way of things. So what were the things that you did in studio during the pandemic? Were they commercial?
They did give me an option. They could have worked. They preferred the studio for consistency.
I get that.
You know, to be honest, the numbers were quite low and I felt comfortable doing that and was grateful to just see people.
Well,
the energy of being in the same room as somebody, especially when you're working on something like a game. But again, it was over at Igloo and everybody was on the TV screen, director and everything. So,
except, and then the engineer was probably on the other side of the glass.
I didn't come in contact with him really at all. But
did they ask you how tall you are before, so they knew where to put the mic?
It was a mic that you wore on your head.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. Have you seen this? It's very like a stereo mic. I know, I miss people too.
It had a headband, and you had a couple little lavalier mics that stuck
out
cool like this.
Looking. Very very good look. But yeah, everything else has been from home and a lot of things. I'm getting more and more auditions where there are very specific specs on the home recording on the side, so that they're looking specifically for, they'll mention like a Sennheiser and a Neumann. They'll want, you know, X noise floor. They'll want you to not do any kind of post-production. So that's shifted because I feel like I used to want to tweak my audio in post just to give it a little zhuzhing. And now I think they're really listening for the true sound of your studio. So I feel that nowadays I'm less likely to do any kind of post on that. I don't know if any other voice actors are experiencing that.
I know that I'm hearing that over and over and over for game voice work. The production values for game voiceover production are, I would say, the highest of anything out there. They are the most careful about the audio quality, the consistency. They are really picky about production quality. And well, for one thing, there's very big budgets on these games. Two, these games go on for years and years and years and years, making new additions constantly. And the voices that you hear in the games, you know, are often being listened to on headphones, and it's incredibly intimate. I haven't been a gamer in many years. I know that you've been on a game. What was the last game that you did that went? They got released.
Well, the Outer Worlds DLC, which just came out on Nintendo Switch. It came out a couple months ago on the other platforms. And that was really interesting because it was a DLC. So the world is pre-built.
DLC. You're throwing jargon at me.
DLC, downloadable content.
Okay, thank you.
Should have said that.
I didn't
know. For everybody
know.
Listening. So it's like, you know, it's like an addition to the game. We recorded, and then 8 weeks later, the game was out, which never happens. Usually in video games, you are waiting and waiting. But that was really interesting because they sent an engineer here in like a hazmat suit.
Whoa.
Interesting. And they set up, I mean, they sound checked, they liked my sound, but they wanted everybody on the same microphone that they wanted. So they sent a computer, a monitor, they sent a microphone, everything.
They sent a whole rig.
They sent a whole rig. They set it up and then they came and took it back. So, but I feel like that's happening less now that we're a year into COVID, and people are just adjusting, and they know that they can find people with the studio sounds that they need and probably save a lot of money.
Yeah, totally, totally. Do you ever get comments on the production value, or I should say the sound quality, or is it just sort of a you never hear anything unless something's wrong kind of thing?
I mean, yes, like the engineer at Nick that worked on something recently was like, you're great. Like your sound is great. Like, don't worry about it, you know, but then, you know, depending upon how you're recording, whether it's Blue Jeans and then they're using, so there's Blue Jeans and Zoom, and a lot of animation sessions are connecting that way so that to get everybody on the same page. And then, so sometimes they're actually seeing you, which is like, okay, I guess
I bet you're being seen. I bet you're being seen now more because of Zoom than you maybe would have been before.
I 100% agree. Hey, Scott, good to see you. You know, I think that when everybody is looking at their screen, they're watching you. Where if you're in a studio, they're not really. They're listening and they're like making notes and everything. So it's always a little awkward.
That's interesting. Yeah, that's really. I always thought that'd be best if the engineer was on camera, because then you can kind of read their face and they make little faces, right? They make little reactions, you know?
Yeah.
And you can kind of read what's going on. You also know if you sound good or not.
Totally.
The engineer, based just on their face, right?
Absolutely. And all those visual cues. Because then you're riding your own levels. So yeah. In games and animation where you're yelling and you're getting really loud, it's one thing for commercial where you don't really touch the
consistent
levels.
Consistent, yeah.
When you have to ride them, that gives me more
Are you
anxiety.
Having to do that? Are you actually finding you're messing with your gain throughout a game, your mic gain throughout a gaming session? Are you turning it up, turning it down?
Yeah, at least for the animation sessions, yes.
And they're telling you to do it though, right?
Yeah.
They're saying, all right, can you give us more?
10 down, 10 dB down.
Wow.
10 dB up.
Really interesting.
So
okay.
It's a lot to think about.
I'm here to learn too, folks. Because, you know, I work with all these folks like Alicyn, and unless I get this conversation with them, I don't even know what their world is like half the time. I'm doing what I think is right for them. And then they come back and say, well, actually, they're asking for this. And I'm like, oh, is that right? Interesting. So, you know, it's really valuable to get feedback from you, the working actor, or Alicyn yourself, or anybody. Don't assume just because I'm the tech guy that I know what's going on in all these studios. Because I know what's going on in all of your studios. But I don't know what's going on in all the studios that you're connecting to. So it's very valuable to get that feedback.
Right. The other, I think, takeaway is like always run a backup on your side if mm-hmm. you're on a Source Connect session, just in case, even if they don't ask for it. I think it's a good idea.
If you've got a properly set up studio, that's so easy to do for you. You shouldn't even have to think twice. It should be very easy to just hit
Absolutely.
Record.
So when it comes to software, obviously a lot of people are using Pro Tools. What do you recommend?
So
for recording software.
If your job as a voice actor is primarily just either being directed on a phone call or Zoom and recording yourself, or just doing auditions and doing self-records, I really think Twisted Wave is the easiest thing to use. Again, it is a Mac specific program. They do have a Windows. Well, it's not a Windows version, but they have a web version. So if you have a web browser, obviously everybody does. If you have Chrome, you can run the Twisted Wave web edition. But it's so simplistic that you really lose out on some features that are really helpful. So if you're on Windows and you don't have a budget for, or don't want to spend the $30 a month for Adobe Audition, for example, then maybe Audacity is fine. A lot of people are going with Reaper on Windows, but I feel it's so much more complex than necessary that unless you have really good guidance on how to set it up, it's a juggernaut. It's more complicated than Pro Tools. Audacity is usually my number one on Windows, just to get started. It's so everybody, so many people know it. Yeah. So many people using it. It's easy to get somebody to help you if you have trouble. I really do love Twisted Wave. I've been tweaking it and dialing it in and making stack processing presets and teaching it for, I think the first tutorial I have, which still is on my website, is from 2007. That's how long I've been using Twisted Wave.
Wow.
And Bo Weaver told me about it. And you're using it mostly? Or are you using
something
100%. Else now? Yeah.
100%. I mean, unless I need to multi-track and record a singing audition that they want.
You use GarageBand or?
Then like, I use GarageBand.
It's fine. I wouldn't want to edit a voiceover in GarageBand, but if you're singing and working over tracks and stuff, that's what it's designed for.
Mm-hmm.
So
Marie asked what we mean when we say run a backup. That would be, so there is a software and hardware called Source Connect that allows the voice actor to connect to the engineer. And when you're on Source Connect, the engineer is recording on their end. So you don't have to worry about it. But when I say run a backup, I mean also open Twisted Wave and record yourself just in case there's a glitch or something goes down. It's just always good to have a backup.
Mm-hmm. And backup. Some productions, video games, more than likely than anything, are such sticklers about quality that they may even say, okay, now send us the wave file that you just recorded during the Source Connect session so we can have the original wave of the audio. So even if the sound quality is nearly indistinguishable, some of them are just so picky. That's what they're going to want anyway. So that's what, yeah, running a backup. That's exactly right. Are we getting other questions? They're probably scrolling off the screen. It's impossible.
Yeah, I want to remind everybody that we'll do about 10 minutes of questions at the end where you can ask George more specific questions. At that little circle top button with the question mark, go ahead and type your questions in there and then I can bring them up at the end.
Okay, cool. I wasn't sure if there was an easy way to do it because everything just scrolls off the bottom. You only see a couple
exactly. comments. So that's the easiest way to do it.
Cool.
And but I am seeing an occasional question. This is nice. It's like a nice intimate conversation. We don't have
really cool.
a million people on here. Mm-hmm. Although a million people is good too. I also am so intrigued because I know you as a person, and obviously there's George the tech, the professional side, but there's also George Whittam. Like, tell us about some of your rad hobbies because you have a few.
Rad, man.
Rad, dude. Oh my God. Wait, I don't want to sound like a boomer again. I'm not a boomer.
Okay, boomer.
Hey, boomer.
I'm a bicycle nut. I actually, you remember BMX bikes, how they had like a pad on the top of the frame?
Oh,
it was
like
a big pad and they'd print stuff on it, right?
Yeah.
And I have one that says rad. And it's still on one of my bikes because, hey, I'm 47. I don't care. This is I had bikes that said rad on them when I was 12 and 15. So for me, it's fun. I'm a bicycle nut. I've been volunteering at a bicycle co-op called the Microwave, named after microwave and a bike together, because there was another place called the Bike Kitchen that started before us, and the name of our shop was obviously a play on continuing that play on words. So I've been a volunteer there for 10 years. I'm what's called a head mechanic, which is sort of like being a manager, but every single person in this place is a volunteer. Not a single person's on payroll. So people voluntarily do the taxes, pay the bills, clean the place a little. It's not the cleanest place in the world, but we really, it's a place where folks can come in normal times, come in and work on their bikes themselves and get some help and guidance and buy cheap parts and get inexpensive bikes. We have been closed we can't have people in to work on their bikes. It's just not. We're not quite ready for that safety wise yet, but you can still come to the shop and buy a bike or buy parts when you're in a pinch. And we're only open at night. So, you know, when everything else is closed, you can come see us. We're opening right now. We're open on Monday nights right now. That's it right now. So microwave.org. But I've been a volunteer there for like 10 years and just, I love biking. Mostly mountain biking is mostly what I'm into, but I'll ride around the area, ride on the roads. I love riding up in Kenneth Hahn Park in Culver City, which is a fun little place to go. Topanga is where I lived for a while. I love riding up there. I know all the secret hidden trails around Topanga. And so that's my primary form of fun, pastime, physical fitness, social outlet. It's all kind of wrapped up in one. Bicycles. So other than that, it doesn't leave a lot of other time to do much else other than be a dad when I have my daughter with me, who's turning 12 in just 3 days.
My gosh. Wow. Time flies.
Yeah. My girlfriend who lives with me here in Venice, she is currently, unfortunately, with her father and in her family. That's not unfortunate, but she's there for unfortunate reasons. She's there to help him recover from cancer. But she's in Iran. Her whole family is in Tehran and around Tehran, Iran. And she's been there for over a month and a half.
Wow.
So I don't know if she's watching right now. She knows about this. It's 6:30 a.m. there. So maybe she's just waking up. But if you're there, yeah. Honey. Hi, Peter Zajun. I miss you. Yeah, that's life here right now. And developing a new website for the company is taking a lot of spare time as well. And just I like being outdoors when I can, you know, because we work indoors a lot is what we do as actors. And I know you do, too. Getting out on the weekends, going a little camping, taking out the trailer, whatever. It's all that stuff's fun. And we're lucky that we can do that pretty much year round here. Really lucky.
I forget how lucky we are.
Yeah, and, just put on the news right now.
What Texas has been going through and my family back east and snowstorms and everything. You do get, you don't ever want to take it for granted, but.
No, definitely not. Definitely not. And I wanted to say while I'm here that if there's anybody watching that knows anybody in Texas who's been directly affected by this, maybe they had a pipe burst in their house and it ruined their whole studio. Or whatever is the case and you're out of gear, and do hit me up. I mean, send me a message, George at george.tech. Just email me because I have gear, you know, I accumulate stuff over time. I get gear from old studios and I've got stuff. I probably have enough to set somebody, not computers, but at least all the other stuff. I have enough stuff to probably set up 3 or 4 studios at least. So.
Yeah, you know, Ashley Turner, VO, says she's in Houston. Ashley, if you've been affected or you have any friends in the voiceover community that have been affected, have them get in touch with George and we'll see if he can.
Yeah, let me know. Let me know. Houston, yeah. You guys got hit bad. So that's what I do. It's a fun life. And it's fun to be able to use my hobby as a way for fitness. And I know for you as well, your hobbies are part of your fitness as well. You've always been into yoga and acro yoga.
Yeah. It's a great way for my husband and I to connect.
Literally. And, I mean, you guys literally have to connect. You're like, it's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it is really fun. I know. I feel like, somebody was saying like, what is it? You're going to post another picture of you with like doing a handstand in your husband's butt. Like, no, those are the outtakes. And maybe that's what we need, like an awkward acro yoga series, because you know, not every picture is like a poster. So there's a lot of like hysterical ones.
For sure.
But yeah, so back to home studios before we go to questions. What are some of your favorite studios that you have designed?
Mm-hmm. Well, definitely yours is one of them for sure.
Oh yeah, that was fun. You want to talk a little bit about that process?
Yeah, well, I mean, yours is neat because we did a standalone. Essentially, it's a tiny house. So if you know what a tiny house is.
Maybe I'll just go ahead and
can you move around?
While you explain. So let me start from outside.
Wow, she can actually go outside and see, you can see the face of it.
I don't know how the lighting is right now.
You can see the siding where the light is there. Yeah. You can see the siding. So it's a tiny house. It's like 10 by 12 feet overall footprint, which was the biggest that we could really make in that area without having to go through permitting and crazy stuff in the city. And it looks like a little tiny house with sliding patio doors. And you'll notice there's 2 sets of sliding patio doors. And this is a big part of the soundproofedness of the space. Every single thing on the outside of the building is double. Double doors, double layers of glass. In fact, some of the windows have up to 8 panes of glass, which is a little overkill. But that's what we got in there. Yeah, and there's a lot of glass, but that's... The windows are not a weak link in this studio. We made sure of that. And then we've got, everything that makes this studio what it is a lot of it's what you don't see. It's inside the walls. It's everything is mounted so that it isolates. Yeah, that's the space between the 2 doors. See how wide that is?
6 inches of insulation.
Yeah, and there's this big space there. So, that's what makes that room so quiet that she can work through just about anything. And then we've got our acoustical treatment, And, you know, I did a minimal, I would say a minimalist approach to the acoustics. We didn't wallpaper the place. As you, if you look, try to look straight up. You know, there's a few panels interspersed on the ceiling, but you can see there's a lot of negative space. And so it took a little doing to figure that out, but I didn't want it to feel like you were completely surrounded by, you know, a foam Iron Maiden.
Yeah.
That's what I call those booths that are lined in that spiky foam, you know. I didn't want it to feel like that at all.
Oh, no. Am I frozen?
No, you're good.
Okay. Seems like it. Somebody said frozen. Okay.
No, you're good now. Yeah. And then we went with a power desk, which is really great. So Alicyn can be working sitting or standing, and it's equally comfortable. And these, fortunately, have gotten very affordable now.
Yeah.
Thankfully. I mean, Costco carries them sometimes. This is great because you can mount everything on the desk. And whether you're sitting or standing, or if you have kids that share your studio. And this was really fun, right? We mounted the gear.
I need a better cable situation, but
yeah, we got a little work to do on
my messy cables.
But you see the rack that's suspended from underneath where she can put things that rides up and down with the table, and it makes it very easy to for anybody of any height to use it. And she can work sitting or standing, and everything moves with it: the monitor, the mics, everything. And then what makes the space really special, is she has a loft. Which is really sweet. Super, super cool. So
yeah.
How often do you go up
there? Library ladder. Oh, every day.
It's a library ladder. Yeah, that was a big deal actually. That had to be made and took some time to get that, I remember.
We had to do some searching, but we did find it. Mm-hmm. And then if you go up here, this is a little meditation nook.
And how about whatnot. That? Amazing. With little porthole windows on the sides.
So cute.
Yeah. It's a super, super neat space. So it is
vision
absolutely
boards.
Yes. It's one of my favorites by far because it's just a fun space to be in, and it's comfortable, and it just looks really cool.
Any studio
where I can go outside the box and not have it be a box are my favorites. David Kay also has a studio that's a bit shaped like this, high vaulted ceiling. Love high vaulted ceilings in a studio.
Yeah.
Howard Parker, I just came from. Also, it's a smallish booth. It's maybe 6x6, but it has a nice high ceiling that follows the ceiling line of the house. So it's very tall. So I love that. It makes the space easier to work in. It sounds acoustically nicer to have all that headroom.
Yeah.
And those are some of my, by far, my most favorite. And if you're watching and I didn't say the name of your studio, sorry.
That's also his favorite.
So many, but there's also, I have to drop a name by far. I have to drop the most famous name in voiceover ever, Don LaFontaine. I got to
I
didn't design in studio, but I was his tech for the few years before he passed away in 2009. And then I got to design a studio in his name at the SAG Foundation. It's called the Don LaFontaine Voiceover Lab. So if you're a SAG-AFTRA member, you can record there for free and take classes there for free. That was something I did as a joint project with a whole bunch of people, but it was really co-founded by Paul Pape and Joe Cipriano and myself. It was Paul's concept initially to do this, I believe, and the three of us are the co-founders. So that's probably my proudest space because it's one of the only things I designed where it benefits thousands and thousands of actors.
Yeah. And you know, it would be really fun if when COVID, you know, is not such a thing, if we went over there and did a live tour, a live stream mm-hmm. of that, that would be really fun. I would love to do that.
It's long overdue. I've gone over there and taught about once a year. I haven't been there in the last year, so I would love to go there again and just be there around it. So it's a lot of fun to be there. So yeah. So if you want to see some of the stuff I've done, go to georgethe.tech. You'll see a studio gallery link on there. And I just try to post all the studios I've done, including Alicyn's. And it's not just pictures of the done studio, it's pictures of the thing being made. So it's, you can see the whole process, what it looks
so
like.
So it's
inside.
georgethe.tech.
That's the website. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm just going to share it here if anybody wants to.
If that's a little confusing, georgethetech.com does work. I have both domains, but that's I like the whole, my name is my address, georgethe.tech.
That's cool. Well, let's go ahead and go to some questions because we still have our giveaway. So let's see if we have a couple questions that popped up in the question box. So
cool.
Let's see. Questions from your viewers will show up here. It's funny. Where did they go? I thought there was four questions, and now I'm clicking on there, and there are no questions.
So I just wiped them out? If you had some, I guess.
Yeah, I think it might have glitched. So if you do have a question, go ahead and type it in again. Mm. But in the meantime, is it time? Are you guys ready?
Let's do it while people put their questions in. Yeah,
we had 54 different entries.
Holy cow.
Yeah. Well, some people got multiple entries because mm-hmm. If you shared it to your stories, you got an additional 5. So I'm just going to start. Ooh, shoot, I just dropped some. You know, maybe I'll have my own game show someday. Okay, so we'll see. I'm going to pull one. And you're all winners. But the winner of the free consultation with George is, oh, look at that. Can you see, guys?
Yeah, I can't.
Jeff Burns.
Awesome.
It makes me really happy that Jeff won. I mean, it would have made me happy. There's a lot of good candidates in here, but Jeff has been on almost every single live stream since we started the show, and we're at 23 episodes now. So,
and you know what? I'm also glad he won because when I type him into my client database, he's not in there.
Oh.
So that's cool.
Yeah.
So we get to work together for the first time, and congratulations. You get 1 hour free time. So email me and george@georgethe.tech.
You won.
And,
congrats, we'll Jeff. Yay!
Set you up.
That's so awesome. I know Jeff's been working on building up his studio, and this is probably really useful.
That's great.
I see Daniel Block has actually an amazing question
that
I have been wondering as well, which is, will AI replace the craft of VO?
AI will replace the craft of VO when AI replaces the craft of symphony orchestras playing on film scores and concert halls. That's when it will replace the craft of voiceover. So has that happened yet? No.
No.
Has AI replaced some of music? Well, if you want to call synthesis or sampled instruments AI, we could say that, I guess. I mean, certainly at the low end of the budget range, there's always going to be synthesizers because that means one person can play all the parts. But when it comes to the big time games, the big time films, all the best production values, people are always going to want people. And people are always going to want to work with people. There is no substitute for working with humans face-to-face or even on Zoom. The energy, the personalities, the nuance of the human voice is so unbelievably detailed. It would take hours and hours, days or weeks or years to program a human voice that sounds convincing and sound that practical. And couldn't you just have a human read it? So,
yeah,
I don't think it's going to happen anytime soon, but there certainly is synthesized voice stuff that's out there. We all know.
I mean,
that.
Things like explainer videos and some of the like long form narration. What about that? I mean, in the next 10 years, don't you see some of that going away?
Yeah. I mean, if you're doing YouTube videos and you're only making $10 in advertising per video, then you're probably, if you need narration, you may not pay a voice actor $100 to do your voiceover. So that there's going to be affordable or low budget jobs or no budget jobs that want to have a voice that just can't swing it. And there are ways to hire voice talent very, very affordably, but the quality can sometimes really be subpar.
Yeah.
There's definitely a get what you pay for in voiceover. So I don't know what's going to happen, but I know there's definitely some apprehension about it in the voiceover community for a reason.
Yeah.
I get that.
Chris Brown is asking, do you prefer the SE2200 or the SE2300 for an upgrade?
Hmm. I know the SE2200 pretty well. In fact, I believe when I was still working with Don, He had one in his studio at one time because they sent him one to try out. The thing about the SE2200 is kind of like the Rode NT1 in that they've been updating it over the years. So there's various iterations of it. There's the 2200A, A2. And I'm Googling this because I can't remember all the different versions that they have. But the 2300 is not one I'm familiar with. This one may be the next iteration of the 2200. But until I've gotten to hear a mic and try it out in my own studio and really compare it, I can't speak to it. So I don't know yet. But if you're going to get one, get it from somewhere that has a return policy. Set it up, record it, get a mic check from me. That's something I do. You can record. Yeah. If you've got a few different mics and things and you're trying to decide, go to my website, look in the tech services and look for a mic check. And you can send me a bunch of samples and I'll help you narrow it down.
Tell us about some of the other services you offer, like effects stacks and...
Yeah, so the effects stack thing, I do that on just about every single audio recording program that's available. And that really is about, mostly about getting great sounding auditions. So it's taking the voiceover that you're providing that should be already good audio and just putting it in a nice suit and tie, basically. Just giving you the best possible presentation that you can. And also trying to make it sound familiar. So when that casting person or even just the client themselves is listening to your audition, when they hear it, it sounds familiar. It sounds like, whoa, that voice sounds like it sounds real. It helps suspend belief a little, disbelief, I guess, because when they're hearing your voice with that, the right amount of processing, just right, yeah, it can sell the audition.
Mm-hmm.
So that's stacks and racks. Yeah. And then the sound check would be just $25 and I'll listen to your audio and give you my pointers about sound quality. And then again, like I said, the mic check would be, I've got a couple of mics and I don't know whether I should use the pad switch or not the pad and the high cut. And should I use figure eight or cardioid? And should I have the mic? So you can record all these samples and I'll tell you, this is the one, this is the best possible sound you're going to get. And that's that helps a lot of people. Like people, that one's popular.
Awesome. That's so great. Tasker asked, .wave or AIFF?
Yeah. So WAV and AIFF files are really interchangeable. They're both what we call PCM audio. So they're really the audio in its most raw form. So whether you record WAV or AIFF doesn't really matter because I think every single DAW recording program can read or write to either. But WAV is developed by Microsoft originally, and AIFF was developed originally by Apple. So the Apple audio file natively would have been an AIFF. It's kind of a tomato. It doesn't matter.
Awesome. Yeah, I always wonder that myself. Well, it looks like we only have a couple minutes left, and I don't know if it's just going to cut us off after 60 minutes, or if it's going to let us go a few minutes longer. So we'll keep going and hope. It's one more question has come in. When you do a sound test for clients, do you only rely on your ears or do you include a visual output to make an evaluation?
No, I rely on my ears. To me, what matters the most is how it translates to me in my hearing. And it's because it's all about the context. And I've heard so many of your voiceovers and studios and stuff that I know what it's supposed to sound like. Mm-hmm. And so it's far more effective for me to just evaluate it based on the way it sounds than anything else, any other metric. But if you want me to do something fancier, let me know. I don't know what that would be. But if you want to see some kind of a waterfall plot or an RTA readout or something else.
Just like emojis, just like happy
emojis. Yeah, maybe I'll have one that's all emojis. I don't know.
That'd be great.
Hey, Gabe.
Just like thumbs up. Awesome. Well, where can we keep in contact with you? Obviously, anybody that's coming over from my side, be sure to follow George on Instagram. But you're also pretty active on Twitter, YouTube. Do you want to give us your...
I'm the most active in terms of day-to-day checking and interacting would be probably still Facebook.
Okay.
So find me as George the Tech on Facebook. I'm pretty active in a bunch of the different Facebook groups. I'm kind of like the genie in the bottle. If you say my name, tag me, I will pop up and become involved in the conversation. So I don't, I try, there's too many groups and I don't browse all of them every day by any long shot. But if you tag me, you might just get, you'll probably, well, okay, no, I can guarantee I will chime in if you tag me on Facebook. So if you tag at George the Techie, I will pop up.
That's great.
Instagram, I'm pretty active. LinkedIn, I post things as well there. Twitter, I post stuff on there, but I'm not a Twitter user that often.
Yep.
And then my show, The Voiceover Body Shop, where you can ask tech questions, email theguys@vobs.tv. And I have a really geeky podcast, a true podcast called The Pro Audio Suite.
Right.
S-U-I-T-E.
With Robert Marshall from Source Robert Connect. Marshall. And Darren Robbo Robertson from Voodoo Sound. And Andrew Peters, the founder of Real-Time Casting.
Yes. And those two folks, the last two, are in Australia. So we do it together. We record all together like a real radio show, but it's a podcast. It's well produced, and if we say so ourselves,
it better be.
And
I mean, pro audio guys. I mean,
it's our names on there, right? So and we interview amazing people. Like we were interviewing some audio engineers. We've interviewed musicians. We've interviewed actors. All kinds of people on there. So it's a lot of fun, and we do take questions offline. People can email us there, but mostly we're just talking to each other and answering questions, riffing on a subject and that kind of thing.
Very cool.
Yay. Car alarm.
Car alarm.
Hallelujah. And by the way, my favorite cartoon characters of all time.
Ren and Stimpy.
Ren and Stimpy.
Is that coming back? I feel like that's coming back again too.
I hope so.
Is that right?
I hope so.
Thank you guys so much for tuning in this week. It's been such a pleasure. If anybody is not already following me, please do, because we have some really great guests coming up in the future. Next week is Dwayne Capizzi, and Dwayne is currently the show writer of the new Carmen Sandiego on Netflix. It's an awesome show. If you haven't seen it yet, check it out. And then we have Rob Paulson coming on. In 2 weeks, we have, Rob Paulson, the legendary voice actor, award-winning voice actor, currently starring in the new Animaniacs reboot. And then in 2 weeks, we have Hope Levy coming on. She plays the mom in Boss Baby. She's the original creator of the Voice Actors Network. And we're going to do a song together. Because
she's really cool. We've interviewed her on our show on VOBS before. Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah. So it'll be so great to play some music with Hope. So I hope you guys tune in, and thank you so much for watching. And George, thank you so much for the giveaway. Jeff, just go ahead and message George. And if you guys like giveaways, shoot me a DM and let me know, and maybe we'll do another one when Rob comes on. Okay, guys, have a wonderful day. Okay, take care. Bye.
This is fun. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you.